Listen, heaven, and pay attention, earth. The Lord has spoken. I raise my children and help them grow, but they have rebelled against me. Oxen know their owners, and donkeys know where their masters feed them, but my people don't understand who feeds them. Will you please rise as we go to our first hymn this morning? If you have your hymnals, or now that the screen is fixed, you can look up on the screen, Faith is a Victory, 216, if you want to turn in your hymnals, 216.
Faith is the victory, faith is the victory, oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
Encamped along the hills of light, ye Christian soldiers rise and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies against the foe in vain.
Behind and onward to the fray. Salvation's helmet on each head, with truth all girt about. The earth shall tremble 'neath the tread and echo with the shout. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the shall begin. Before the angels he shall know his name confessed in hand. Then onward from the hills of light, our hearts with love aflame, we'll vanquish all the hosts of night in Jesus' conquering name. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh,
please bow with me this morning. Dear most gracious and holy Father, how wonderful it is to be able to call you our Father. In all the world, even man cannot create or imagine a God such as you, one who loves his children above all, one who has created us and the world we live in with such magnificence, one who sees his children suffer in their bondage to sin, and sacrifices his only son to give us freedom from that bondage. One who is able to overcome all obstacles, yet say that obstacles are mere nothingness to overcome. Small minds doubt you, and other small minds create deaf, dumb, and fake idols to worship. In the name of such gods, men encourage and engage in such butchery as we have seen and will continue to see from the Middle East. There is no forgiveness or love to be found from these empty vessels and deaf and dumb idols. Your love is real, and it will stand eternal. One day you will claim all that is yours, and those men will stand as the prophets of Baal stood before Elijah, waiting, wailing and gnashing their teeth and hacking themselves, for they will receive no answer or protection. Judges who hold power today and defy your holy word will also stand before you and tremble. We are your beloved, and our beloved is you. Hold us always close to you, for it is in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. You may be seated as we go to our next hymn, People Need the Lord.
Every day they pass me by. I can see it in your eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where.
As we get ready for our responsive reading this morning from Psalms 54, 3 and 4, I've got a comment to make about it. Psalms 52 through 55 point directly to the Great Tribulation period. Brother will betray brother. It will be a time again of awful betrayal. During the tribulation period, the godless Antichrist will be in power, and the Jewish remnant will suffer greatly under this man of sin. Thankfully, the church will be gone from here, and there will be great suffering for those who have not accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Strangers are risen up against me. They have not set God before them. Amen. Bless the reading of God's word. Our memory verse for this month, 2 Timothy 2, 4, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. 2 Timothy 4, 22. Good job, Charlie. Good job. All right. They were closing their eyes, and that's a good job. Our praise hymn this morning, Meekness and Majesty.
Bow down and worship.
yet learns obedience, death on the cross, suffering to give us life, conquering through sacrifice. And as they crucify, praise Father for you. Frailty appears, Lord of infinity, stooping so tenderly, lifts our humanity to the heights of His throne. Oh, what a mystery, meekness and majesty, bow down and worship.
And it's good to see all of you and all of you that are watching from home as well. You know, when I looked earlier this week on a computer, it was supposed to be a rainy day today, but it's going to be a beautiful day. And it was a beautiful day yesterday. We barbecued and did all kinds of stuff to get ready for today, because we're celebrating everybody's birthday today. It happens to be my birthday today, but Jean had one just a short time ago. Sharon's going to have one soon. So we like birthdays. If you have a birthday and you want to celebrate it, you know, give us a call out here. We've invited many people to come this morning. Unfortunately, Miriam had trouble with her car, and she wanted to come, but she asked to have a prayer, and so we will keep her in prayer as well, as she's having some difficulties in prayer. Mary wanted to come, but she still struggling with her foot, and it makes it a long day, I know, to do all of that. I want to make sure that everybody knows that that they can get a hold of us out here at 814-967-3628. If you are able to get the radio. I talked to Mary this week, and she said, the first thing I'm going to do is go get a radio so I can hear you on the radio program Sunday mornings at 9:15 on any of the local AM or FM channels around here, the Allegheny News Talk Sports Network. There's, I think, three AM channels, three FM channels, something like that, and good people over there. And same way, we're here through the stream and Armstrong Cable, and we'll be here Sunday night and Wednesday morning at 9, and you can pick us up on YouTube and Facebook and all kinds of places. We're really struggling and striving to get the gospel of Jesus Christ out every way we possibly can do that. Little country out here in no place, but we're getting the word. Sometimes I pray and hope that we're kind of like Elijah. And I don't mean that, but Elijah, as difficult a time as Elijah had, he still got his word out to the nation. So anyway. So it's good to see all of you that are watching. I'm still looking for letters from people who are writing from different, watch us from different foreign away places. If you are, please send me a card at P.O. Box 41, Titusville Community Bible Church, or you can write Reverend Babcock there and send me a card. You don't have to put any money in it, and I'm not going to be bugging you for money, but, you know, like every church now, you know, we do need money, and it's amazing. If you notice this morning, we got the screen back up. Thank God I was able to use eBay, and I thank God for the people that he put me in contact with that wound up getting us a really nice screen, and that it could have been real expensive, but God took care of us. You know, and it's been amazing the last couple of weeks. I mean, because it started with the tractor going out, and, you know, we've had a lot of things just happen, one right after another over here, that could have caused us just kind of okay, I give up. I can't handle anything more, right? I mean, it's just been dumping one thing after another. The garden tractor went out. Well, I had an old one in storage, and it happened to be very similar to the one here, and we got it over here and swapped parts, and it worked just fine. We got that running, and then I jumped on the good mower, the good thing, and that went out, and found out that was a battery. Wasn't major, but it needed to be fixed. You know, then this week, and then we had the screen go out, but we got that fixed, and that didn't hurt. And then this week, Polly and I get here. We weren't going to come in on Tuesday because we had so many other things to do, but we decided at the last minute to come in, and I go to the freezer, and the ice is melting in the freezer. And so I said, well, we've got a refrigerator going out. The ice is melting. Because I asked Polly, I thought, did you just make ice? And she said, no, that's in there from last week. So this is just truly an amazing story about the refrigerator, because I hunted all over. I got up early Wednesday morning. I started making telephone calls, and I went down to Rent-A-Center, and they didn't have one. Ran all over the place looking for a used refrigerator because, you know, I mean, we don't have lots of money. And so I went to all of these places, and nobody had anything. I even went to Ken Mallory at the General's, because he knows everybody, and he couldn't find one for me either. And so I was going to head out to town, and I decided, okay, I'm going to go see Gene, and went out to camp and told Gene that the freezer refrigerator was going out. And he said, I don't know what to do. And then I head back here, and I called. I called Erie, and I called Waterford, I called Meadville, called a bunch of places. And the phone rang, and it was Linda. She said, we found a refrigerator. And I said, you did? And she says, yeah. And so, can you want to come and look at it? And I said, yeah, be right over. I'll jump in my car, pull over, and they told me where it was at, and I needed to find them. And so I get over, and it's perfect. It's beautiful, side by side, fits right in the spot. This is a nice refrigerator. Work. That gentleman that we bought it from was very nice young man. Had rental properties in Titusville. So then I asked him, well, did you go on Craigslist? Did you go to the newspaper? How did you find that? And he said, well, I went uptown to the used place to see if they were open, but like you said, they were closed, and I decided we were going to go get something to eat, and so I took the back way over to where I was going to go get something to eat, and all of a sudden there was a refrigerator there, just out on the lawn, and Gene said, I have to ask Linda, is that a refrigerator? What is that? That's a refrigerator. So we And he had just put it out. So praise the Lord. We got it here, got it cleaned up, got it put away. But God works in. God continues to work and bless us here. Even when things appear to go bad, even when things appear to give us a struggle, you know, God works miracles in wonderful ways. So, you know, I know that because, you know, we bring lots of prayers from people and around to the Lord, and you know, he has a remarkable track record of answering prayer that comes from here and those, because you, whether it's Mary or Nora or Miriam or Marian or all the rest of you that are home and praying, we know that our prayers, all of our prayers, come together and go to the Lord, and that's amazing. And there's times that I know that you're praying for me, even when I'm down and out. When I sometimes get depressed, like everybody else, I get to feeling low or not enough sleep and too many things. And, you know, I'll get a card or I'll get a phone call and say, boy, I really like that sermon. And that just lifts me right back up. You know, God knows even when I'm down. So, you know, we still have bills that are coming due, but we're still on the radio, and we're still moving forward with that. Anyone else this morning have a praise or prayer request this morning? As you bring your prayer praises and prayer requests to us, yes, Charlie.
That Sharon's here.
That what?
Uh-huh.
The praise that everyone is here. Yes. Uh-huh. All right. Anyone else this morning? Let's lift our prayers to the Lord. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the many, many things that you do for us. We thank you for watching over us and taking care of us and always being here. And we just ask you to continue to give us the courage and the strength never to give up, to keep being your soldiers, your people here that keep spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. We ask you to be with this country and our leaders and our military, and we certainly ask you to be with those in Haiti and out in California with the fires and in Afghanistan and many, many places around the world that are really struggling. We just ask you to continue to watch over us and guide us and lead us. We ask you to be with those who lift their prayers from home this morning or this evening or Wednesday morning or whenever they watch this program, to be with us and answer their prayers as well. Watch over us and guide us in Jesus' name. And for his sake we pray. Amen. scripture this morning is from Isaiah 45. We're continuing on in the book. I'm going to say that again later, but Isaiah 45, 20 through 25. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me. And then while you're turning there, you might stick your finger back in Isaiah chapter 13. We'll go back there for a minute as well. Assemble yourselves and come, draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations, that have no knowledge, that set up the wood of their graven images and pray unto a God that cannot save. Tell ye and bring them near, yea, let them take counsel together, who hath declared this from ancient time. Who hath told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me, a just God and a Savior. There is none beside me. Look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness and shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear, surely shall one say, in the Lord have I righteousness and strength. Even to him shall men come, and all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed. In the Lord shall all the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory. The who? The Medes? Interestingly, God's prophecies about Cyrus and the rise of the Persian Empire were given 200 years before Babylon or the Median and Persian Empire were ever in existence or even a thought outside the knowledge of God. As Isaiah had no understanding about what God was telling him to write, but Isaiah wrote those things as God had directed him anyway. Isaiah never saw these prophecies come to being, yet God knew exactly what was going to happen way before it happened. This is one of the teasers from God or Yahweh. We find the one true God, Jehovah, Moses' I Am, telling Israel, Isaiah, to write, who are these false, dumb, carved out of wood, fashioned in gold and silver idols anyway? Who are they? Can they tell the future? If they can do anything, tell them to make themselves present and known. Come stand before me. Show me something. Tell the world what will happen as I have. And of course, God sat down and has waited thousands of years for some dumb idol to step forward and answer. And in all this time, none have. But in the meantime, the one true God has given us lots of prophecies to look forward to, coming true, and each and every one of them have come true. And to the world's surprise, they have come true just as Jehovah, God, Yahweh, the I Am, said they would. And we are watching that come true right before our very eyes this week, just as I said last week. As my answer to the question, where is God? He's right here. What you see going on around us is God bringing this world, this population of humanity, to judgment, to close. Sometimes I'm really amazed. You probably haven't figured it out yet, but I have been taking us through the Psalms on a regular, steady course. I might read something different for Mother's Day or Easter or Christmas, but then it's back again to the schedule I asked God to help me set up quite some time ago. And when I say I am amazed, I shouldn't be. But what does amaze me is that I am reading our responsive reading and discover that what has long been planned for this week really fits in with what just happened in our world. We are in the Psalms talking about the millennium, what will happen during the tribulation period. And likewise, I thought I might preach from a different book of the Bible this week. I really struggled with that this week about where am I going to go. Lord, I really, you know, don't feel about going into Isaiah 45, but I was given no message as I prayed and prayed and prayed for God to lead me. But right where we left off last week and are supposed to resume this week, once again, fits exactly into our current events. What is happening right before our very eyes and ears on the world stage. I could have taken us to where Paul is upset with those who won't sit down together and eat with others, where Paul was upset with Peter for sitting and socializing with the Jews but ignoring the Gentiles. That was high on my list as we were getting ready for a barbecue and a birthday party here. But that's not what is going on around us this week and where the Lord took me back to. What is going on is just what is happening in the very next chapter of Isaiah. Last week I was in chapter 44, and this week I'm in chapter 45. I don't know if anything that has happened this past week has meant much to many of you, but it has to me. Not only because I see the fulfillment of Bible prophecy in what is happening, but also because I am ex-military. I still have connections and interest in the nether regions of the world. Not so much as I used to, because we're all getting older and our generations are dying off. But many of my friends have children carrying out with family traditions, just as some attorney families continue on to be lawyers generation after generation, or farmers and ranchers families continue on the farm generation after generation. You may get the idea, if you have watched any of the news, that things are deteriorating and have deteriorated tremendously in Afghanistan. But we have no interest, we are told there. So we need to pull out. You may also be getting the message that things there aren't too awfully terrible. But that's not the truth. A young man, an Afghan, spent the last 10 years of his life working with a special U.S. military unit. During his time, he had gotten married and had three beautiful children. Just the other day, one of the retirees from that unit who had been in Afghanistan, had worked with this translator and was very close to him and his family, received a telephone call from one of the wife's relatives. The call began with, "I have some very bad news to tell you. Your friend Hami is dead." As soon as the Taliban entered the city where Hami and his family lived, they began going door to door, house to house, looking for everyone who had worked with the Americans. They found Hami on the very first day. They took him outside and shot him in both of his knees, forcing him to be on his knees. Then they cut off both of his arms. That wasn't enough. They brought out his wife and raped her repeatedly, forcing him to watch. After they were finished with her, they beheaded her and threw her small, torn, bloody body to the ground as if she were nothing more than a scrap of meat to be tossed to the dogs. Next, they brought out his oldest boy and made him watch as they tortured, beat, humiliated, and finally beheaded him, tossing his limp and lifeless body to the ground as well. Next, they brought his youngest son and repeated all the tortures they had committed against his older brother, and finally beheaded and tossed his body on the ground. Next, they brought in his 10-year-old daughter and sold her into slavery to the matchmakers, who would sell her to some Taliban soldier. And finally, they cut off Hami's head and dumped his body onto the ground. No one was allowed to touch or move or bury any of the bodies or pieces of bodies. Their lifeless reminder to everyone else just what happens. I got rid of my cable TV service several months ago, and truthfully, I haven't missed it. I do get a couple bleed over TV channels that still comes in over the internet that I kept. One of them is the news. I had just mowed my yard, so I was tired and I needed a nap. So I laid down to turn on the news channel for white noise so I could take a nap because of the tinnitus that I still have from Vietnam. But I was shaken by Angela Merkel, the Chancellor of Germany, saying, "Well, this is the end of NATO." Almost immediately after that, the channel switched to the British Parliament, where they were nearly in tears, angrily and shouting, and it was it was sad to watch as they one after another said England would never again ally with the United States, that the United States could never again be trusted to stay the course. The empire, the greatest power ever created on this planet, had just collapsed. And I was watching as I saw that, as and I felt that in my heart. God had foretold us that would happen. Oh, he didn't use the term United States because no one ever knew about this side of the planet, but even 200 years before the rise of the first Babylon, God had foretold about the collapse of the second Babylon. The first Babylon, God said, would rise to great power and wealth. They would put their trust and faith in their wealth and might and false idols. As a result, the great Babylon would fall, never to rise again, and it never has. But the decadence, the idolatry, God said, will once again rise and inhabit the world. The future Babylon will be the greatest commercial center, a great religious center, a great political center, a power center, a military might the world had never known and will never know again. The second Babylon will be the educational center of the world again. It will be the banking and financial center of the world. Scripture makes it clear that the first Babylon will never rise again. Many thought that the second Babylon would be the rise of the Roman Empire, but there has been 5 attempts to raise the old Roman carcass, and they have all failed. The new Babylon will not be the rise of the old Roman Empire. We always want to see ourselves as the good guys. We all wear white hats here. We're so good. But that bloom fell off that rose this week. We're the second Babylon. It's clear, and our fall has been predicted. I immediately was brought in my mind to Daniel's prophecy of the 4 beasts in chapter 7. And the 4 great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I beheld it till the wings thereof were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. As I watched and listened to the British Parliament, one after another, tearfully insisting that they would never again ally with the United States, that the U.S. could never be trusted again to stay the course, I was sure I was witnessing the plucking of the eagle's wings off of the lion. England has always been referred to as the lion. But in Daniel's prophecy, the lion was propped up by the eagle's wings, the United States propping up England. But Daniel tells us those wings will be plucked off, and England will be forced to stand up on her own feet. I pray the heart that Daniel saw giving will be a heart for Christianity. There has never been any doubt that the eagle's wings have always meant and represented the United States of America. The leopard seems to have always represented Germany, and it appears that we will once again see some rise in Germany. Verse 6 says, and dominion was given to it, the leopard, who just proclaimed that NATO was finished. Revelation prophecies speak of the dragon rising. Personally, I've always wondered and thought that China was the dragon of philosophy, or prophecy rather. And certainly China, the red communist dragon, rose this past week. I want you to listen to God speak his prophecy about the future from Isaiah 13. I want to start my series from Isaiah several weeks ago here, but God had me wait on that. I didn't know why then, but I believe I know now why. This is a more fitting time. Listen to Isaiah 13, 14 through 22. Then they'll be like hunted gazelles and like sheep with no one to gather them. Everyone will turn to his own people and flee to his own land. Whoever is found will be stabbed to death. Whoever is captured will be executed. Their little children will be smashed to death right before their eyes. Their houses will be looted and their wives raped. I believe that I just told you that story for real. As the decent people of the world all flee to their own houses and lands. Oh, you say that could mean anything, but listen carefully to the text. Next verse, 17, I'm going to stir up the Medes, God says, against them. They don't care for silver and aren't happy with gold, but their bowls will smash the youth. They'll have no compassion for babies, nor will they look with pity on children. Babylon, the jewel of the kingdoms, the proud beauty, the virgin daughter of the Chaldeans. The only reference I can apply this to is Sarah, Abraham's wife. Both her and Abraham came from Ur, the Chaldees, before Abraham's father Terah moved them to Haran in Cana. I believe that this speaks of a virgin nation that had never been before in the world and did not come out from another nation, or the growth or breakup of another nation. This Babylon was virgin born. Do you see the United States here, as I do? Isaiah 47, 1 through 5 says, come down and sit in the dust, O virgin daughter of Babylon. Sit on the ground. I think that's what just has happened. There is no throne, O daughter of the Chaldeans, for thou shalt no more be called tender and delicate. There has never been a king or throne in the U.S. Obviously, this nation had before this admonition been called tender and delicate. Both tender and delicate in years, meaning new on the world stage, or young and tender and delicate in compassion for others. But something immediately happens, and this nation, this once great nation, is now called to sit in the dust, as we see Lot is called to sit in the dust. Take the millstones and grind meal. Uncover thy locks and make bare the legs. Uncover the thighs, pass over the rivers. Thy nakedness shall be uncovered, yea, thy shame shall be seen. I will take vengeance and I will not meet thee as a man. As for our Redeemer, the Lord of hosts is his name, the Holy One of Israel. Sit thou silent and get thee into darkness, O daughter of the Chaldeans, for thou shalt no more be called the Lady of Kingdoms. I jumped over Isaiah 13 through 17. I am going to stir up the Medes against them. They don't care for silver and aren't happy with gold, but their bows will smash the young. They will have no compassion for babies, nor will they look with pity on children. Who are the Medes? All of this time I have spent to circle back to this question. So let's look back upon on the screen as we take a look at history, geography, religion, and genealogy. Of course, the Middle East, you know, is over here. All this area, Afghanistan, all this part is part of it. This is the Middle East, from the Hindu Kush all the way to the Aegean Sea. This is all the Middle East. At one time, that whole section was the Median Empire that God says he is going to raise up. It's the Afghans, it's the Kurds, you notice that Persia is just a little piece down here. This was the Persian, the connection included some places, but most of this is the Median Empire. The Medes that God has Isaiah write about, that he will stir up. Remember, Isaiah has no idea about these Medes because God is telling Isaiah to write this 200 years before there is a Medes. But God says that he will once again stir up the Medes to destroy Babylon. We know, looking backward, that it was the Medes who conquered the first Babylon. There is going to be dancing in the mountains, the Bible says, and their voice will be heard across the planet. Well, we saw pictures of that this week. I believe that this is what just happened. The Medes and Persians are not the same people, people think they are. We've been looking for the rise of the old Persian Empire, but that's not going to happen. But look again at the map, as I showed you. The Persians are this little people down here. They are not this great Median Empire. You are correct if you say that the Medes are not the same as the Afghans, but you are also incorrect. There is one very important concept about the Medes. They were originally in the middle between the two. They mixed in the West with the Kurds and intermarried, and they have become one people with the Kurds. They mixed also with the Afghans and intermarried with them and have become one people with them. Interesting, the Kurds and the Medes and the Afghans are really one people. And even though the Medes united with the Persians to their south to form the Medes and Persian Empire that Alexander the Great brought down, the Medes are known to have never intermarried with the Persians. Or it probably is the other way around. The true Persians don't mix with other races. This answers many of the problems I have seen coming for some time. Turkey is in a predicament. I have always predicted that prophecy warns us that Turkey will be linked with the Russians, with the Mughal Empire. If Angela Merkel is correct and we just saw the collapse of NATO, Turkey will realign with Russia. They'll have to. And they will have to because they have a huge Kurdish or Median population that they have always had trouble with. The Taliban has just defeated the people whose God is Jehovah. They will be exporting their God Allah. Don't believe that they're going to stay home. Every place they can. They have just inherited billions and billions of dollars worth of military hardware and munitions, and they will be the largest narco state in this planet. They can build an empire, the greatest army that religion or that region has ever seen, and they won't stay in Afghanistan. God, Yahweh, Jehovah told us this would happen 200 years before the Medes or Babylons ever existed, and He has gotten it correct right down to the minutest detail. Just watch as it unfolds. I am going to stir up the Medes, God says, and we see them today dancing in the streets, and we will see this played out all across the old Median Empire. And when that happens, which I believe won't take very long, Israel will be isolated and all alone. Will the U.S. come to their rescue? In my mind, the U.S. will never again be able to put together a coalition of like-minded allies. The world has just been fractured, and the greatest empire the world has ever seen has just been brought down. Yes, Babylon still has power to go to no longer, but no longer credibility on the world stage. The next thing that will happen here at home as the Medes continue their stirring up and taking over is a banking collapse that will further isolate the U.S. This may be the thing that happens where the American Jews finally hear God's command to return home back to Jerusalem and stop being disobedient. The bright spot in the future is that things are going to get terrible. They are going to get so terrible that the U.S. will sell her soul to the Antichrist, as our psalm said, to regain the power and prestige that has just been lost. And I don't believe that it will take much time before that will happen. As everything is happening these days, I believe it will come just as fast and just as furious. And over in verse 21, the Bible tells us and says, satyrs will dance. There, satyrs are demons. Satyrs will dance in Babylon, Isaiah tells us. But thankfully, God isn't through with the world. I believe that Christ will return soon and spare the true church from the terribleness that is going to happen. And it will happen just as God has said everything else will happen. God has never been wrong, not even once yet. And it will happen like a flash in a blink of an eye. As I said, God will not be through. He has given us an honorable out, a true and and faithful place to be. He says, look unto me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. We need a Savior, and Jesus Christ is that answer. You're watching the Bible unfold right before your very eyes. You can be lied to by Satan, or you can open your eyes and look at reality. And that reality is that you need a Savior. And there is only one Savior who can be trusted in through any circumstance. There is only one Savior you can depend upon to be there through thick and thin. There is only one Savior that will never break his word to you. And there is only one Savior who can keep you in the palm of his hand, that even Satan and all of the Taliban or Medes or Kurds or Persians or monsters or spacemen can never defeat or cause to surrender to give up. One Savior who will always be victorious, and that's not the U.S. It's the one who sits on majesty on high. There's a beautiful little story from London about this verse, Isaiah 45:22. There was a pastor one Sunday morning who was on his way to church to preach a beautiful sermon he had spent days to prepare. It was instantly halted in a street by a sudden and terrible and awful storm that came. The wind and rain came so that the pastor had to take refuge. He looked around. Where could he find refuge from this storm? Who would be open Sunday morning? He was getting sopping wet, and the wind was really driving him. He started to become frightened, that he'd be swept away by the storm. When all of a sudden he spied a very tiny, very small church on a corner. So he headed into the wind and into the rain to the church to take refuge. He finally was able to walk in, only a small congregation there. So he took the farthest back seat in the very back of the church. But as he sat there, a small congregation became in turmoil, whispering back and forth to each other. It appeared that their pastor had been halted by the same storm, it had appeared, and there was no one to preach the morning message. An elder gentleman reluctantly got to his feet. It reminds me of Gene, huh? Being pushed by his wife to take the pulpit. It was clear he wasn't prepared to preach. After a minute or two of fumbling around, he opened his Bible to this Isaiah 45:20. Look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. And what that tiny old man lacked in lightning, he made up for in thunder. He said, this verse says, look unto me and be saved. He began to talk about the verse. God says, you should look to him and be saved, he said. By that time, that man ran out of his ammunition. He had said all he could say about the verse. So he went into the thunder department and began to roar and pound on the pulpit. Look to God, all the ends of the earth, and be saved, he pounded out. Then he looked way back in the congregation and saw a young fellow sitting there with a very miserable look on his face. The old man pointed his little bony finger directly at the young man in the back of the church, and he says, you look to Jesus, and you will be saved. At that time in his life, this man was a very brilliant man with a very brilliant head knowledge of Jesus Christ. That old man pointed that old bony finger right at this young man's heart. And at that moment, the young man knew God was speaking directly to him. He had been preaching. He knew he had a head full of Jesus, but there was that bony finger pointing at his heart that he knew was empty. He did what the ignorant old man suggested. He did just then look to Jesus and ask Jesus to come into his heart, and he was saved. And Charles Spurgeon went on to be one of the greatest ministers of the gospel we have ever known. Majesty. Worship his majesty.
His majesty, unto
to Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, both from his throne unto his own, his anthem raised. So lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship his majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Majesty, worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flows from his throne unto his own, his anthem raised. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Worship his majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Charlie, I'm going to call you to take our offering as I speak to our last words to those that are going from home. Please know, in these troubled times, you have a Savior, you have a Lord, and He is there for you.